first interview for today, which of course has to do with the protest called by CAN, the Christian Association of Nigeria, over incessant killings of Christians and innocent Nigerians in some parts of the country. I have with me in the studio the Edo State Chairman, Ewing Khan. I'd like to thank very especially Reverend Phil Aroji for joining this program. Thank you for coming.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
Okay. The protest, across the country, that was a call or a declaration by CAN, the Christian Association of Nigeria. At least we had reports from Lagos, from Benue, which has been the epicenter of the killings, and then, of course, from Ibadan as well. How would you describe the response by the church to this call?
Thank you very much. On Friday, the 27th of April, the CAN at the national level had a meeting where a press conference was addressed at the National Christian Center. And part of the directive from that press conference was that a protest should be held in churches across the nation, and it should be within the premises of the church, because nobody knows what the security agencies could do or people could hijack it. And the protest was scheduled for 2 days, the 29th of April, which was yesterday, and of course the 6th of May, which is next Sunday.
Okay.
So yesterday was part one.
Okay.
And then of course the part two will be next Sunday. It was not only for Christians in Nigeria. Christians who are Nigerians but live outside the shores of this country were also asked to protest and then draw the attention of the host government in whichever country they live to the things happening in Nigeria. You will agree with me that we have lost count of the number of persons that have died. Now, you will observe that yesterday, maybe from your news, that the protest wasn't so solid in Benin City.
Yeah.
It wasn't so solid. It's not because we boycotted the protest. CAN has 5 blocks. And instruction, I'm not speaking for CAN on this platform, but in my position as the chairman of the UWE, CAN, I also have insight to what's happening. CAN has 5 blocks. The chairman of CAN, after that meeting in Abuja on Friday, had not returned back to Benin.
Okay.
He could have called for a meeting.
Meeting. Before
and
then,
yes,
an
then
action
instruction would be given.
Given.
Because I listened to your news on radio yesterday evening,
okay,
and they interviewed some Christian leaders who said they didn't have direct instruction. Yes, because CAN in Edo State is very vibrant, led by Pentecostal firebrand Bishop Orina Moyenedokure. It's very vibrant, and whatever directive from the national level will carry it out. And then the Catholic Archbishop of Benin City, Archbishop Augustine Akubeze, Obiora Akubeze, is also the chairman of the Catholic Bishop Conference in Nigeria. That also gives us another edge, because he's the leader of CSN, which is a block of CAN. CSN is the Catholic Secretary of Nigeria. He's the leader in Edo State.
Okay.
So we have a lot of role to play in galvanizing this.
Okay.
Don't forget that a few days ago, the Catholic Bishop Conference had a protest on their own, calling on the president and the security agencies to put an end to this, because we have had so many dead. So this is phase one,
okay,
yesterday.
Okay.
Of course, part two is there.
Okay.
And on Sunday, the 6th of
so you expect that level of response?
Of course, will be heavier.
Okay, now just a quick one. This response just now, isn't it too late in terms of the amount of lives destroyed? I mean, properties destroyed, and the spate of the killings, isn't this too late?
Yes, we are people under authority. The leadership of CAN, in their wisdom, knew what they were doing. And even these protests, from the insight we had, after they have called for this protest, they were even invited for a meeting that, look, we know you want to protest, but you can meet with the president and all the rest. That's why, as if the thing was a little watered down.
Okay.
Pressure comes also at that level. Pressure comes at that level. You want to do something, government is talking to you, look, we can negotiate, we can discuss and all the rest. Okay. Pressure comes. So it is not too late. The wisdom of the fathers of faith, they decided on what to do at the right time to do it. And even if today now they say, okay, no more protests, we'd have no right to query them because they also know better than us. But for now, they have given us instruction to protest and we'll. I think that part of the problem we have in the body of Christ is that sometimes we don't speak with one voice, but thank God Khan is speaking now. Otherwise, what led to all of this crisis? You find people speaking from different angles. People like Reverend Father Mbaka should be ashamed of themselves because they brought this upon the nation. They were the one who didn't see beyond where they were. And today, they can't speak. Do you know what it takes, how many years, and how much effort is put into train a Reverend Father? And in one day, two Reverend Fathers are slaughtered. They were not in the farm. They don't have anything to do with herdsmen or farmers. They were in the sanctuary, and a catechist, and then 17 or more other worshippers were killed. Even yesterday, they were also killing in Kaduna. So people who spoke in 2015 and said what they didn't know should be ashamed of themselves, because Christians are now at the receiving end. We are now at the receiving end. So whatever the fathers of faith in this nation tell us to do as a people, we'll do. If they say we should block the road, we'll block the road. We're only waiting for the instruction. Whatever they tell us to do. And for now, they have said we should protest. So we can't say it came too late. It came at the right time because they understand also the dynamics of the politics, both in the church and, of course, in the political environment.
Well, what's the greatest misgivings about all of these attacks, interfacing that with the level of response by the government as well as security agencies?
The government is sleeping, as far as I'm concerned. That's my personal opinion, and I'm entitled to it. That Professor Wole Soyinka said only just now, only yesterday, that it is ethnic cleansing. I'm quoting him. It's reported in the papers today that it is ethnic cleansing that is going on. The former chief of the former Minister of Defense, Theophilus Zanjuma, a month ago, said that Christians should defend, people should defend themselves. People in Benue have said they will defend themselves since the government cannot defend them. I have said it before. When this crisis started on January 1 this year, same night, 1st of January, 15 persons were killed in Rivers on their way back from the Watch of My Service, and then 70-something persons were killed in Benue. It took less than 2 weeks for the killers in Benue to be brought to book. Don Win and his brother, they brought them to book. Why will it take 4 months? Today is the last day of the fourth month. Not one person had been tried. Not one person had been arrested in Benue State. And the killing is still ongoing. Are you aware that somebody, the Fulani herdsmen that killed the young man, the undergraduate in Eastern Land, about 6 weeks ago, has he been arrested? Has anybody been arrested? What of the people that killed Pastor Runsele in Ovia here? Has anybody been arrested? Why is the government taking eternity to do anything? So as far as I'm concerned, the government is not doing anything, but less of doing enough. Like people have said, that government is even aiding these people. In fact, Khan issued a statement that government is statically supporting them. If not, you can't have people being killed and people being slaughtered on a daily basis. God said, I hate the wicked. And anybody that supports wicked person hates God, and God doesn't like that person. The government is not doing anything at all.
How do you justify that statement now, again interfacing it with the fact that there was a recent report that the chief mastermind of the killings in Benue State has been arrested.
Arrested by
and
who?
Then, of course, that some soldiers were also killed in the process. Those soldiers were probably not in their houses. They were on the front line engaging these people. Isn't that a statement of commitment and indication of how the government is responding to this
the
issue?
The chief mastermind of the killing in Benue State, before the Reverend Fathers were killed or after? If you have arrested anybody and the killing is still going, you have not done anything. Because before now, there wasn't killing in Benue. People were not being slaughtered in Nasarawa State. People were not being slaughtered in Plateau. People were not being slaughtered in Taraba State. The soldiers I heard was killed in the community, one soldier, and then the military went there and raised down about 300 houses. That's the report I heard. And I've not seen anybody, all the soldiers have been killed. Unfortunately, we ought not to lose one soldier. We ought not to lose one. We shouldn't lose any Nigerian. Not even somebody that we have spent money in training. Those soldiers have family. I have lost people in the armed forces, people I know directly, personally, to this crisis. This crisis ought to have ended. My brother, what will you tell me about the young lady called Leah from Yobe State, from that in Yobe State, that you took, it was alleged that 110 girls were carried away, and then they returned them in broad daylight and addressed a press conference there, and then they kept only one girl because she's a Christian, and we should be happy. Christians are not happy. We are weeping. Even if we are pretending as if things are okay, Christians are not happy. We are being marginalized. We are being slaughtered. It is ethnic cleansing. And it's just coming. Look at the side it's coming from. It's coming from Taraba. Bornu have a lot of Christians to Taraba, to Plateau, Nasarab, Benue. Got to Enugu one time. It has ended Edo. He didn't go to Kwara. In Kaduna State, he stayed within Southern Kaduna. He didn't go to Central and Northern Kaduna. He didn't go to Sokoto. He didn't go to Zamfara. He didn't go to West. The West he went to, he stayed only in the Kiti State. What's happening? It's ethnic cleansing. And I agree with those who have said so. We are not happy. The government at, in a those days, we shouldn't even have such crisis. Because we have a Christian governor, we have a Christian commissioner of police, we have a Christian director of SSS. These people are doing their best to the level of their capacity that they can do it. But they are not the one that controls, that calls the shot. The shot is being called from Abuja. And everything ends at the president table. And that's what he ought to have done more. Don't go to UK and tell Nigerians that we are lazy. We are not lazy people. Nigerian youths are not lazy. We are hardworking people. We are doing the best we can do, even in a very difficult situation. And despite that, people have been slaughtered. People's farmland have been taken away. People can't go to church. You can't count the number of churches that have been destroyed. How can you kill a reverend father in a sanctuary? That's uncalled for. That does not represent us well as a nation. And then everybody go on as if nothing is happening. The president go on as if nothing is happening. They are looking, they are thinking of the next election. They are removing the cap of the senator for the next election. Not the number of people that are being killed. Look at what's happening. The helicopter or the military fighter jet or whatever they call it that they want to buy. If you convert that money, $496 million, if you convert it to Naira at the rate of 360 Naira to a dollar, it is 178 billion Naira. 178 billion. And from the reports we have read, the same configuration of fighter jet was sold to Afghanistan for $10.2 million. And our own is costing, each one is costing $41 million. What is happening? Now, no explanation. You paid for this thing over 3 months ago. It took you 3 months to write to the National Assembly. And this thing is not to be delivered today, it's to be delivered in 2020. Why this year? Why did you not pay for it before? Why not wait? Why not? What is happening? Who are you going to fight with those? I mean, why? What fight are you fighting against corruption with that kind of figures that you cannot even defend? And people ask questions. We are told, don't say anything, don't see anything, don't do nothing. Anytime you say anything, they say you are a willer, you are on opposition, you are PDP. It doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense at all. Things are not being properly done. And you cannot justify whatever wrong you are doing now by the wrong that was done in time past. You see people in government, unfortunately, defending this fighter jet now that President Obasanjo, the then president, withdrew 17 point something billion dollars from the EC, the SS Code account, without making reference or recourse to the National Assembly. That Goodluck Jonathan drew money from the SS Code account without the National Assembly. Why can't the president do the same? I thought that's why we voted for change now. Is that not why we asked for change? How do you justify the wrongdoing of other persons to justify the wrong you are doing now? How do you, the Bible says they that compare themselves with themselves are not wise. If you are wise, you should not compare yourself with those you say they are bad. No, you should do things differently. It is left for Nigerians. My counsel as a youth leader of CAN in Edo State and PFN, that every young man who is not lazy should have a PVC. Okay. If you don't have a PVC, you are lazy.
Okay. Probably a pull-out from the last part of your comment, which has to do with the purchase of fighter jets, as it were. It has attracted a lot of reaction. I mean, you saw the incident at the Benin airport where Senator Matthew Okede was at the mercy of youths who were there to perhaps question the motion that he moved, that the action was an impeachable offense on the part of the president. Could you just make two comments on that before we call it a wrap?
That incident that happened at the Benin airport on Friday was an unfortunate incident. In fact, I'm even ashamed of those persons who went there, whether for or against, whether you were for APC or for PDP, that you even left what you were supposed to do and you went to the Benin airport to be drumming and playing drum. You can't find reasonable people to go and do that. And then, sadly enough, the commissioner of police was there, the governor was there, and the situation went on uncontrolled to the point that the serving senator was manhandled. I don't think that the people who did what they did there, even at the highest level, did the right thing. But we leave them to God and to posterity to judge whether they have done well. We leave them. Senator Matthew Orohide said what he has to say at the floor of the National Assembly, and he's entitled to his opinion. Any other senator could say any other thing, and if you feel that what he said was not right, we have other representatives. Let them go and say something. Because it is better you say something and die than not say anything. We have people from Edo State here who have never made any statement at the National Assembly. We have them. And then the one that is speaking, you want to show them. If you don't like what they have said, of course, you cannot remove the president by mere statement. Let other people say something. And of course, senators from other parts of the country said things, oh, you cannot do that and all the rest. It was unreasonable. It was uncalled for. It was wrong for people to go to the airport and wait for a man who has said something that he was elected to say. We cannot have democracy that way. It is not right. Coming back to the figures, do you know that in Benin City, Edo State Police Command don't have devices, equipment to track kidnappers? I was there yesterday evening. Something took me there to the police command, and I had to discuss with them at that level. They don't have device. If you take from the 170 billion that you want to use to buy to Kana fighter jet, if you take only 25% of that amount of money to equip the Nigerian police, you won't need to buy those fighter jets because they can handle the insurgents themselves. Nigerian military and Nigerian police can do it. It is just the political will and the directive that they have not given to them. They can fight these miscreants. They can deal with the husband. Who are they? What do they have? Even Nigerians who are not in the military, we can defend ourselves. We can. There is no way Fulani husband or killers can come to a community and destroy the community. If we are allowed to defend ourselves, we'll defend ourselves. Go and equip the police. They don't have enough vehicles. Buy vehicles for them. When last did the federal government buy vehicles for the police? All the vehicles you see, most of them came from the state government. The black ones, the Nissan black ones, was the one that the former AG bought, 2,500 pieces of them, and they distributed, the one they wrote Safer Highway. All the other white ones you see are the ones that the state government bought and gave to them, either for protection, thunderstorm, and all the rest. The federal government is not equipping police. They should take the money and give to police and pay the men that are doing the work. This guy go and sleep in the bush and all the rest, and then you are going to buy a helicopter that they will deliver in 2020. With the way Fulani herdsmen or killers are killing people now, are you sure there will still be people left in 2020 before those things will come? Okay, will the people be there? Because people are killed every day. I don't have the figures, but as at the end of March, 1,351 Nigerians have been killed. That was the Vanguard newspaper report. 1,351 Nigerians have been killed. If you put the figure together, that was average of 20 persons per day. Not those that died of Lassa fever or died of malaria or died of other diseases. People that died violently, either by road accident or killed by Boko Haram or Fulani herdsmen or court-related issues. 20 persons per day as at the end of first quarter. And this is where we are. Are you aware that this is the end of April and we don't have budget? There is no budget in 2018.
Okay.
No budget at the end of April.
That's a matter for another.
No, it's not. Look at where we are.
Let me just thank you for the useful insights that you brought to bear on this protest called for by the Christian Association of Nigeria. He just told us that is in two phases.
Yes.
Phase one was yesterday. The second phase is on the 6th
of May. And everybody should get ready, except the father says otherwise.
Pastor Phil, we'll just leave it at that. We'll leave it at that. That's it on this segment of the show. Thank you, Pastor Phil, for coming on the show. It's the TMI Monday. We'll take a short break. I'll be back with the rest of our guests on our discussion segments. Don't go anywhere.